Question is from Mike Bossio, please.
Thank you so much, Minister, for being here today and being answering our questions fully. We appreciate that. Under the review of legislation and the nation-to-nation relationship and all the ways that we're trying to change our relationship with Indigenous peoples in Canada, I'm wondering, you know, I think at the root of a lot of it is self-determination and being able to expand that so that First Nations have self-determination over education, over health, over resource extraction, over environmental protection, etc. Is that part of you know, in this legislative review and in your relationship with Indigenous peoples, is that part and parcel of the end goal of what we're trying to accomplish?
Absolutely, and I think that I thank you for that, because I think that it gives us an opportunity to talk about what happens when First Nations or communities feel in control of the choices and setting their own priorities. And so, you know, and I know there's been some in British Columbia, the Chandler and Lalonde report that showed that the communities that were in charge of health, education, justice, back doing their ceremonies, that they watched the suicide rate in those communities just drop dramatically. And so it's a matter of a sense of control over your life that gives people hope, and the idea of secure personal cultural identity, we know, is the key to dealing with overcoming social determinants into healthy choices, good health outcomes, good education outcomes, good economic outcomes. But it is about being in control and in that sovereignty. Yeah.
So in being able to do that, though, I notice in the estimates that a large a chunk of the estimates is grants, and I look at that and I go, okay, so what kind of long-term sustainable funding is there for there to be self-determination through a grant-like process? Are those funds dedicated dollars to specific purposes or specific nations, or how, you know, it's very difficult to try to understand what that really means.
Well, as you saw in the mandate letter, I am charged with evolving a new fiscal relationship. And again, that you've heard many First Nations say they would rather have a transfer than little grants that you get a little money for this, a little money for this, and a little bit of money, and don't you dare move the money from here over to here, because you're going to get caught, and it doesn't work. And so we're watching communities needing to rob Peter to pay Paul and to be able to address emerging urgent needs in their community. So that's where we're hoping to go. That's what, whether it's land management or whether it's moving along the continuum to self-government, that's what we're hoping in it. And in terms of the Minister of Justice, that was her role at the AFN under the governance, was actually being able to help people when they're ready and able to be able to take more and more control and to build that capacity in First Nations.
So finally, and I know I'm running out of time, but I know we've talked about lifting the 2% funding cap. And so once again, this kind of leads into the same discussion that there are huge deficits now that have accumulated in many of the budgets to First Nations. And now, how do we now just start from the new slate and say, okay, from here on now we're going to have a new funding formula, or do we go back and go, okay, these are the deficits, we're going to try to eliminate those deficits so it's a level playing field, so that moving forward, Does it become a permanent type of funding formula, or how is that going to work?
So as you know, the 2% cap was actually an escalator, mm-hmm. But it then didn't keep up, right? Frankly, in the devastating budget of 1995, the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister had to choose that in order to protect that my department, from the across-the-board cuts that were happening to every other department, they put in this 2% escalator to make sure that the fastest growing population was getting a little bit of an increase while all the other departments were being cut. That being said, it stayed in place way too long, and Kelowna would have lifted it, but now we're in the business of having to just stop the music and start again. And we hope that the investments that we're making in budget 2016 will begin that, but also the way going forward will be much more in keeping with the fastest growing population and the needs.
Thank you so much, Minister.